Great. Hi, you guys. Today we're looking at lenses. So if you remember in our last lesson, we looked at reflection and refraction. And so this is kind of taking it a step forward where we're looking at how light would pass through different materials that we use as lenses and how that refraction is actually going to affect basically the rays of light to form virtual and real images. So in order for an object to be considered a lens, it has to be made of a transparent material, obviously, so that the light can pass through it. And it has to have an index of refraction higher than air. So that way the light will refract as it passes through. Okay. So all lenses are broken into two groups, depending on whether they focus light at a point, which is called a converging lens, or if they spread the light out, which is called a diverging lens. So converging lenses are thicker at the center. So over here you can see two examples of two different types of converging lenses. And so when something's thicker at the center than at the edges, we call it convex. Okay. And so two types of converging lenses would be biconvex. So bi meaning two, and then convex is that kind of bowed out shape. So it's saying that it's convex on both sides. Or we can have plano convex, which means one side is convex and the other side is a flat plane. Okay, diverging lenses are thicker at the edges than at the center, so they kind of go inwards, basically the exact opposite shape. And again, we have two types, biconcave, so we see the concave shape on both sides of the lens, or plano concave, where we see a plane on one side, a flat plane, and then the concave shape on the other side. So for lenses, there's two refractions, one when the ray enters the lens and one when the ray exits the lens. So based on what you guys know about refraction, you should be able to look at this first lens here and think about how you can explain the refractions using the law of refraction that we looked at in the previous lesson. So remember, if we have the incident ray coming in, then we always want to draw a normal line that's going to be perpendicular with the surface, okay? And so here we can see we've done that. We have the normal line, and it's at 90 degrees to the surface. And so the angles that we're looking at for refraction are the angle of the incident ray with the normal line. So here's our ray, there's our normal line. And then coming through the other side, same thing. So now, because our lens is always going to be a higher index of refraction, remember that that means that it's going to bend towards the normal inside of this medium. And so we see a smaller angle here. I could actually barely even draw it in there. A smaller angle here between the normal line and the ray. Now if we move to the other side where we're moving out of the lens, we do the same thing, right? So we have a normal line drawn here that has a 90 degree angle with the surface of our lens, and so the incident ray is going to be having like a certain angle when it comes in, but as it leaves and it moves into air, which is our lower index of refraction, that means it's going to bend away from the normal. Okay, so when it's moving into higher, it's bending towards. When it's moving into lower, it's bending away, and so we see a larger angle here. And so this ends up basically helping us to understand why convex or converging lenses make light behave the way that it does. So think about the word converging. When we say converging, it means there are two things or more things are coming together, right? And if you look at this, if we have one ray here and it's pointing in, the rest of the rays are going to do kind of the same thing, and they're actually all going to end up bending towards a point. Okay, and we'll see that more when we move into the next page. Now, if we look at a concave lens, the same kind of rules apply. So we have the incident ray here, and then again, we would want to draw a normal line that's 90 degrees. Now, this is a little bit trickier because it's kind of like quite a curved surface, but we can see that this is approximately 90 degrees right there with this surface, okay? And so then we have the angle that our ray forms with the normal line. When it goes through the other side into the higher index of refraction, remember that means that our angle between the ray and the normal line is going to be smaller. Okay, so it's the same as the rule that we see above. But because of the way that this shape is different, we're actually going to see a difference in how light goes out. Because here, if it's bending away from the normal, or sorry, towards the normal line, it actually ends up moving slightly upwards. And then again, when we move out into air, so moving into a lower index of refraction, again, we have this normal line, 90 degrees with the surface. And when the ray leaves into the lower index of refraction of air, then it's going to bend away from the normal, and that would be moving upwards. And so this is going to end up scattering the light rays. So from using these laws of refraction, we can actually see the differences in how these two types of lenses work. Okay. So when you're completing ray diagrams for lenses, so kind of like what we just did, but we'll be doing looking at more of the rays, then basically you have to include a principal axis and a principal plane. So this is kind of like a typical ray diagram. And basically what you can see here is we have all the rays coming in, right? And then we use our laws of refraction to see how they all bend. Or in this case, because there's no angle with the normal line, they go straight through. But then when we see down here, they end up bending up towards, and so they end up all converging on one point. Now, what we're all using with relation to this is the principal axis and the principal plane. The principal axis is basically the line that goes straight through the center of this lens and follows, like essentially like what the ray of light that would go straight through there would be. So an imaginary line that's perpendicular to the lens and cuts the length of the lens in half. Okay. Now for converging lenses, that's also going to end up having one of our focus points on it, which we'll look at in a minute. The other component here is the principal plane, which runs perpendicular to the principal axis, and it cuts the lens in half lengthwise. The way that I kind of always remember which one is which is I just know that planes go up, which sounds really simple, but it helps me to remember it. Planes go up, so I know the principal plane is always going up, and then that means the principal axis has to be going horizontally. Okay, so let's see what else. Oh, and then the other really important thing would be the focal points. Focal points can exist on both sides of the lens. They're basically the point through where all parallel rays meet after passing through a lens. Okay, so it's the point where they're kind of converging. The other thing we have is an optical center, and so that's basically just right in the very middle of the lens there. Okay, so we can do the same kind of a drawing for a diverging lens or a concave lens. So exact same idea, principal axis is going to run straight through the middle of the lens horizontally, so it's going to pass through that optical center that we see in the middle of the lens. And then we're going to have a principal plane that divides the lens in half lengthwise. Okay. Now, there's a little bit of a difference here in our focal length. You can see that our focus is extending kind of behind this lens, and we'll look a little bit more in detail at why that is in a few minutes here. So when we have an object placed in front of a lens, then images can be produced and they can have different characteristics. Okay, so the image can either be smaller, it can be the same size, or it can be larger or magnified. Okay, now you'll see that there's different terminologies for some of these. Like sometimes you might see it's minimized or it's enlarged. So just be aware that there can be different terms for that. Another one would be, instead of larger, it could be magnified, which is another factor that we'll look at more later on. The other thing is the orientation. So the image can actually end up being inverted, and inverted just means that the image you see is flipped from what it actually is, or it can be upright or erect. So either one of these words, again, we have different terminologies that you can use to represent it, which basically just means that the image is oriented in the same way that the original object was. The last thing is you have different image types. So you can have a virtual image, which is an image that can be seen, but it can't be projected on a screen because the image and the object are on the same side of the lens. Okay, so we'll go through some examples of where you would see that later on here. For example, one thing that you might be familiar with is a magnifying glass. When you're seeing that magnified image of the letters that you're looking at, it's a virtual image because it's behind the lens, okay? Versus real images, which get projected outside of the lens, okay? Like a projector screen would be an example of that. And that shows that it can actually be projected onto something. So that means that it's a real image. Okay. Now, real images can be seen or can be projected onto a screen, so just like I just said, because the images and the object are on the opposite side of the lens. So again, if we look at this kind of real-life example, oops, where did that go? If we look at this kind of real-life example here, you can kind of see, I might need to zoom this in a little bit. But basically, you can see you have a bulb here that's shining a light through, and you have an object, like usually in this case it would be a piece of film that's going to show something, right? But it has to be upside down because when it passes through the lens, the image is going to be inverted, so it's going to be upright, but it will be a real image because it can be projected. And the other thing is, often it's going to be enlarged, right? Because we don't want to look at a screen that has the same size image as you would have in a projector. We want to have it much, much larger. Okay. So there's a video that you guys can check out if you're interested. It talks a little bit about lenses and virtual images, and so that should help you to understand the material a little bit better. So if you want, you can always pause the video here, watch this video really quickly, and then come back to the lesson. So if you're looking at drawing ray diagrams for lenses, so unlike these previous ones where we see that a whole bunch of different lines are drawn, basically what we're doing when we're drawing a ray diagram is we're thinking about kind of three main rules for how the light will travel and using those rules to understand how an image will form, okay? So the first rule that we have only applies to converging lenses, so convex lenses. And basically what this rule says is any ray that passes through the focus will refract parallel to the principal axis. So essentially, if you have, so for all of these as we move forward, the object is the thing that I've highlighted in yellow. Okay. I don't know how well that shows up on this particular camera, but maybe I'll see if I can get a bit of a better light on that. So basically, the object is highlighted in yellow. So essentially, if we have an object here, the object is reflecting light, right? And so if its light passes through the focal point on this side of the lens, then when it's going to hit the actual lens, it's going to be refracted parallel to the principal axis. Okay. Now the second rule applies to both types of lenses, but kind of in different ways. So the second rule is that any ray that's parallel to the principal axis will refract so that it passes through the focus. So basically, if you think about the fact that light is going to be reflected off of this image in a straight kind of like parallel to the principal axis kind of manner, then when it hits the lens, it's going to be refracted through the focal point on the opposite side of the lens. Okay. So now if we combine rule one, which I've highlighted in orange for the rest of these, which is where it passes through the focal point on the same side of the lens, and then it refracts parallel to the principal axis. And our second rule, which is that we see the light moving parallel to the principal axis, but then when it refracts through the lens, it's going to go through this focal point on the opposite side. Now the new thing that gets introduced with this rule is both of these are real rays that are happening, right? So light can be reflected off in various different directions from an object. And so what we're going to see here is that together, when these two beams meet, or rays meet, wherever they cross over, we actually get an image, okay? And so all for all of the rest of the questions, I've highlighted the image in green. And then what we want to be able to do is from our image and where it is and how it looks, we want to be able to determine its characteristics. So any image that's on the opposite side of the lens from the object is going to be real. Okay, and so because we have our object here and we have our image on the opposite side of the lens, we know that it's real. Now the other thing is we can look and see this arrow compared to this arrow. This arrow is larger, so we know that our image will also be enlarged. And then the last thing is because our image shows up down on the bottom side of the principal axis, whereas our object is on the top side, we know that our image is also inverted. Okay? So, like I mentioned, for concave lenses, this is a little bit of a different scenario. So basically what happens is a ray will hit the lens and diverge. So instead of here where we see that it does refract, I guess, but it goes towards the principal axis. The difference here with the concave lens is that it travels parallel to the principal axis, it hits the center of our concave lens, and it's actually going to refract upwards. So it's diverging instead of converging. And so because of that, the place, what we usually want to do with something like this is we want to extend our line for the ray backwards. And what we see is that this line that refracts is going to pass through the focal point that's on the same side of the lens as the object is in this case. Okay, so the big difference here is that for a convex lens, we're going to see the refraction happening so that the ray passes through the focal point on the opposite side of the lens. For a concave lens, we see it being refracted so that if we extend the ray back to the focal point on the same side as the object, it will pass through that focal point. Okay. And I think I wrote that maybe, I was having a hard time figuring out how to word this, so maybe this might be a little bit confusing, because I think what I was thinking here is, because I wrote, the angle of the diverging ray will be such that if it extended backwards, it would pass through the focus on the opposite side of the lens. And what I meant there is the opposite side of what we would see for a converging lens. Okay, so don't get confused by that. It's on the same side as the object, but it's on the opposite side of the focus point that we would expect to see it moving through for a convex lens. Okay. All right, we have one more rule to look at. So this is rule number 3. And so with rule number 3, it says, and again, this one applies to both, any ray that passes through the optical center of the lens will come out the other side without any refraction. Okay, so we have our first two rules represented with the blue and the orange. Now the last rule we have here is represented with the pink. So if we have a ray that's coming from this object, and it goes straight through the center, optical focus, optical center. Okay, I thought that seemed too easy, but yeah, it is optical center. Okay, so if this passes through the optical center right here, that's going to be the path that it will take, right? And so again, we see all three of these rays are converging in this point on the opposite side, which are producing an image. And again, you can tell because it's on the bottom side that it's going to be inverted. Because it's on the opposite side of the lens from the object, it's going to be real, and it's also going to be larger. Okay. Now with our concave lens, so our diverging lens, we have the same rule. So remember, rule 1 does not apply to our concave lens. So only rule 2 and rule 3. So with rule 2, we had the ray diffracting away. Now with this one, we see that the ray is going straight through the optical center and it just keeps on going, right? And so what actually ends up happening with the concave lens that you can now see is that this imaginary line that we can kind of extend back from this ray converges with the line from our rule number 3 here. And this actually produces an image. However, because the image is on the same side of the lens as the object is, it's going to be virtual. Okay, so we should add that in. Image is going to be virtual. And then think to yourself, what else do you think in terms of size and in terms of is it inverted or upright? Okay, so you can always pause it a second if you need to, but if you guess that it's going to be upright, you're correct, right? Because it's on the same side as the object. And if you guess that it's going to be smaller or diminished, you are correct as well, because you can actually see that it's smaller than the object itself. Okay? So, and I kind of mentioned that again down here. So the real image forms where the refracted rays meet after passing through the lens. However, the virtual image is going to form when the rays pass through kind of a point before the lens or on the same side of the lens as the object. Okay, so let's try some examples of that. Sorry, this is actually my filled-in copy that I have for you guys, but I would like you guys to be able to work through these ones with me. So let's have a look here. So using a ray diagram, determine the image attributes for the following. So an object located beyond 2F prime. So we could use this one here, right? So if this is our object, and that's another thing to kind of be aware of. With converging lenses, usually the focal points that are on the same side as the object are called F primes because they come from the object and then after. The ones after, are not prime. They're just F and 2F. However, with a concave lens, it's the opposite. So if this lens were to be concave, then our F prime and our 2F prime would be here, and this would be our 2F and our F. And the reason for that is because with the concave lens, our image is going to form over here. Okay. All right, so let's have a look here. So we want to basically be able to use our rules to figure out what kind of an image is going to form if we have this object that's beyond 2F, so basically further away from the lens than 2F. So, let's see, rule number one would be that if it passes through the focal point, so that would be F here, then wherever it hits the lens, it's going to refract so that it's perpendicular, okay? So usually you want to start from the top of the lens, and then sketch your line going down and through until it hits the principal plane of the lens. Once it hits that, now it's going to be refracted perpendicular. So now it can be a little bit tricky because you kind of want to make sure that you're going somewhat straight. But essentially that's what our ray will look like to start out with. Okay. Now the second rule is talking about the fact that if this ray goes straight across, so again, I'll just try and make this as straight as I can. So if this goes straight across, then when it hits the principal axis of the lens, now it's actually going to pass through the focal point on the other side of the lens. So we can kind of line those two up and then draw in our line. And now we can see that we have a cross line there. Okay. Now the last thing is, our last third rule is that a ray that goes straight through the center is going to just keep going straight through the center, right? So essentially, we can just line up our ruler so that it goes straight through that center point and then draw a straight line. And so now we can see from our ray diagram that right about here is where we're going to see an image, okay? And so we're going to see the image being like that. So what we're being asked to do is determine the image attributes for this. So always you want to answer these questions by saying afterwards, the image is, in this case, is it real or is it virtual? Well, because it's on the opposite side of the lens as the object, it's real. Because it's on the opposite side of the principal axis as the object, it's inverted. And because what would you say looks like the size compared to the object? Well, obviously it's smaller. So you can either write smaller or diminished. It doesn't really matter which one. But yeah, that's basically how we would do one like that. Let's try another one here. Now, it is important to kind of be aware these aren't always going to be super, super precise, because it is hard to say, like, if you start a little bit further down or a little bit further up, or if your ruler is a little bit off of the center, right? But you should get the general idea from these types of questions. So the next one is, we have an object located at F prime. So for some reason, this one didn't come with the primes in there. But basically, we have an object located at F prime. So I'm just going to draw kind of, this is kind of our original object we were dealing with. So let's just kind of make a little bit of a replica of that over here. Okay, so this is going to be our actual object we'll work with. So remember now, we want to start out with rule one. So rule one would say that if we go through this focus point, then it's going to hit the ray and then refract parallel to the principal axis. If you have an object that's actually on F or past F, you can't use rule one, okay? Because it would have to be an object beyond F in order to have a ray that passes through F. So we can skip rule number one and we can go right to rule number two. And so with rule number two, we know that if this line kind of goes, or if a ray comes kind of straight off of our object, then it's going to hit the principal plane of our lens, and then it's going to be refracted down through the focal point on the opposite side of the lens. Okay, so that's going to be our ray. Now, we can also use rule three, which is where if our ray comes off the top of this object, it's going to go through the center of our lens. And so we can see from this that essentially, and it's kind of hard to say because, again, these aren't always super precise, but if it looks like there's almost no chance of these meeting up, like it does in this case, right? It looks like these are almost running parallel, other than probably my own error. So basically what I can say for this one is no image will be formed. So essentially, if it looks like the rays are not going to intersect, then you say no image is formed, okay? All right, last one, we have an object located between the lens and F prime. Okay, so again, I'll just put in these primes. So it's between the lens and F prime. So let's say we have an object kind of somewhere around here. I'll again try and do a little bit of a replica of this. Okay. Okay, so there's our object. And so again, remember, we can't use rule one because rule one would require the object to be beyond F prime in order to pass through there. So we'll start with rule number two, where we have a ray coming off of here horizontally. It's going to hit the principal plane of our lens, and then it's going to be refracted to go through the focal point on the opposite side of the lens. Okay. Let's see, what else do we have? An object located between... Oh, and then we have rule number three. So we're going to see that this ray, if it passes right through the center, we see now that actually what happens is these lines are moving further away from each other. Now, the tricky thing with a situation like this is if you see these lines are moving further away from each other, what you actually need to do is extend the lines to the opposite side and show kind of like the virtual component to the ray. So basically, this line would be going kind of like that, and this line would be going like this. So if we see that these rays do converge on the opposite side here, then basically what that means is, I think I might have drawn that a little bit, not quite. Well, it's as good as it's going to get. So basically we have a convergence point here. And so essentially what we can say here is now this is kind of our like our image. But if our image is on the same side of the lens as the object, what does that tell us about our image? I kind of forgot to do this. Normally I like to draw my image with a dotted line, Especially if it's virtual. So that's kind of, I just gave it away to you guys. So because we have these extended rays that aren't the actual original refracted rays, we end up seeing that this image over here is going to be virtual. It's on the same side of the lens as the object is. Now the other thing you can tell is if this is our original object, we can see that this is enlarged. And what else do we need to talk about? Virtual, enlarged, and is it upright or inverted? Well, we can see that they're both on the same side of the principal axis, and so that means that they're upright. The image is upright. Okay, so that's basically how you work with ray diagrams for lenses. So you guys can go ahead and give a practice question a try here on page 679. And maybe take a look at how some of these real life applications work now that you know how the ray diagrams work. You can kind of see here some of the interesting things that we use, like, for example, taking a picture. In this one, it's like the really old school one with actual film, but it's still kind of the same idea where essentially you have the object coming in, like the light rays that are refracted off of an object or reflected off of an object rather, pass through the lens of the camera, and they are refracted so that they come to a point which is going to form an image. Now the image does end up being inverted, okay, and that ends up being kind of undone when we actually process the picture to print it or to show it on a screen. But that is essentially how film works. And same thing with actually how your eyes work, which is interesting. Let's see. Same thing, and I already just talked about the projector and the magnifying glass. So those are all examples of where we see this happening in real life. Okay, so I'm going to break this this lesson into two parts, because the next component is going to involve looking at using a bunch of different formulas to do some calculations with these types of questions. So we'll look at that next time.